Hi, and thanks for joining us tonight at Family of God Community Church. Thanks for joining us again as we continue in our study of the Beatitudes found in Matthew chapter 5. Tonight, we're going to look at finding your missing piece. Let's all pray together. Father, we thank you for your wonderful love. May you give us your wondrous blessings. May you teach us through the power and the presence of your Spirit. And Lord Jesus, may you be glorified as we lift you up this night. For we give ourselves in this time of study unto you. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Thank you for joining us tonight. I hope that you will have enjoyed this particular series as we continue to move forward. This is the next to the last lesson in this series. Tonight we're looking at a passage of Scripture in verse 9, which says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God." And I think that's important. There are a couple of places where Christians are referred to as the children of God or the sons of God. One is in the Gospel of John in the first chapter. I don't know if you're aware of this, but The Bible says that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is the living Word, referring to Jesus Christ himself, because in verse 12 it says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, full of grace and truth." And then it says, "As many as received him, to them gave he power to be called the sons of God." And so the sons of God is a unique reference that's found in the scripture that is attributed to believers in Jesus Christ. Now, ladies, don't get upset. The scriptures are very clear in what they represent. And the reason it uses the term sons is not to place men above women. As a matter of fact, it is to elevate women to the position of an inheritor. You see, in the culture during that time period, only sons could effectively inherit the lands or the properties that belonged to the father. And there were certain exceptions. For example, if there were no sons, then of course the land would go to the daughters. But what this does is it equates you. This word in the scripture literally is a reference to an inheritor. In other words, you are eligible to inherit the wonders and the glory of all that God has for you in the future. And so it actually equates. It doesn't detract. So I want you to know that before we even begin. Because after all, we need to be peacemakers, right? Well, let's look at this particular element and talk a little bit about peacekeeping. Now, there are some things you should be aware of. There are a few misconceptions about peacekeeping. When we look at peacekeeping, we have these ideas that the maintaining of peace is accomplished by essentially two things. First of all, we think that we can just avoid the issue, avoid the person, avoid the circumstance or situation. And true peacemaking or true peacekeeping is not about avoiding. As a matter of fact, it's the opposite. It's about being prepared to deal with the situation when it arises. As a pastor, I can assure you that anyone in a position of responsibility and leadership, they get into conflict. You cannot avoid it. No one likes it, but nonetheless, it is ever present. And one of the things you learn about peacekeeping, it is not avoiding. You have to deal with the issue at hand. The second thing that we often have a misconception about is it's not only not avoiding a situation, it's also not appeasement. There are some people that just dynamically want their way. They want to win. And sometimes the reason there's a conflict is because of a violation of God's word or a violation of scripture or a violation of behavior that's appropriate for a believer in Jesus Christ. And appeasing that behavior or appeasing that false doctrine or appeasing that violation of God's word is not appropriate in any way, shape, or form. And you cannot always look at appeasement as being the answer to conflict. And so peacemaking is not avoiding the issue, but on the other hand, it's not appeasement either. We live in a society right now that is frustrated and desperately needs peace. And one of the primary elements of the situation is there seems to be a demand for appeasement. Well, appeasement is not going to answer the problem. The problem's still going to be there. The conflict's still going to exist because appeasement does not answer the issues that are a part of the problem. And so these two misconceptions, it's not avoiding, it's not appeasement. You need to understand those before you even begin to comprehend about peacekeeping. Now, why should I, as a believer in Jesus Christ, be a peacemaker? Well, there are a number of reasons why. First of all, here in this passage in Matthew 5:9, it says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God." The rhetorical implication of that is by being a peacemaker, you and I are representing who we are. We're representing that we are the children of God, that we are demonstrating that behavior in our lives. What was it Jesus said? "By this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another." And so we should be peacemakers. But let's look at some specific reasons why you and I, as believers in Jesus Christ, should be peacemakers. First of all, because unresolved conflict causes problems. there are people in your life right now where there is unresolved conflict. You say, well, let me think. Yeah, there are always people that we have unresolved conflict with. And so unresolved conflict causes problems. You and I need to bear that in mind. And I think if you'll think back on situations and circumstances and individuals that you once had a vibrant, loving relationship with that are now strained in some respect, it's because of the problems that are associated with conflict. So let's look at this. First of all, when we have this unresolved conflict, it blocks my fellowship with God. When you and I have this unresolved conflict, it blocks my fellowship with God. In 1 John chapter 4, verses 20 and 21, the aged apostle writes these words and he says, "Whoever says, 'I love God,' but hates another believer is a liar." That's very strong terms. You know, we sometimes look at Paul the apostle, who was very blunt, that he had strong terms. Or even Peter, who jumped out of the boat. He was the quick one to make statements. But here John uses strong terminology. The beloved apostle, the quiet one. He says, if you say you love God, but you hate another believer, you're a liar. You don't love God. He said, people who don't love other believers, whom they have seen, can't love God, whom they have not seen. You've never had God in front of you and seen Him. How do you love Him if you can't love the brethren in Christ, if you cannot love another believer? The Bible says Christ has given us this commandment. There are a number of commandments that you and I possess that come directly from Jesus Christ. They're in addition to the what we call the Ten Commandments. These are the commandments of Christ. This is one of them. Here He's given us this commandment. The person who loves God must also love other believers. You and I have to understand the concept of this. Now, this word for love is not the word phileo, which means a brotherly, friendly love. No, it's not that. It is a love of acceptance. It's a love that is unconditional. In other words, I love you. I may not like your behavior. I may not like your opinions. I may not like your ideas. I may not like the way you said that. I may not like the situation that you put me in, but I want you to know I love you. I love you. And love does no harm. We do not seek to harm people. We do not want to get back. We do not want to hurt them. And so here in this passage, he says, if you say you love God, but you hate another believer, and by the way, that word hate is a reference to meaning, I despise you. I turn you aside. I don't want anything to do with you. I don't even want to see your face. If that is the attitude that you have toward another believer in Jesus Christ, and you say you love God, you're a liar. It destroys your fellowship with God. Is that found elsewhere in the Scriptures? Absolutely. As a matter of fact, in the very next chapter of Matthew chapter 6, the Bible says that the apostles came to Him and said, Lord, teach us how to pray. And of course, He gave us the great example that we often refer to as the Lord's Prayer, but in reality, it's the disciples' prayer. And you're familiar with it? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. That is the key element. After He had given that explanation of the elements of prayer that we need in our lives, He said this, if you forgive not others their trespasses against you, neither will your Father who is in heaven forgive the trespasses that you have against Him. And so it's very important. He emphasized that more than anything else in the Lord's Prayer. He emphasized it in such a way that He said, you've got to knock off this anger and bitterness and hatred. You've got to knock out this unforgiving spirit that you have toward other people. You have got to learn to forgive. Now, when it says, neither will the Father forgive you, your sins, if you don't forgive the sins of others, He said this, does that mean that God does not forgive your sins and you're going to hell when you die? No. But what it does mean is that you will not find the freedom and peace of forgiveness in your life between you and God. It's not going to happen. You're just not going to possess it. As a matter of fact, there's a passage found in Matthew chapter 18 where God talks specifically, or Jesus is talking specifically about forgiveness. And he said, listen, you've got to be reconciled. You've got to forgive one another. You've got to work out your differences, because if you don't forgive someone, now some people don't need to meet with someone to forgive them. Some people just, it's in their nature. I just forgive you. I'm not going to carry that burden. I'm not going to hold you hostage. I'm going to overlook that offense, and I'm just going to forgive. I don't need to bring it up or talk about it. I've just overlooked it. I'm not going to deal with that because I hold no animosity. I forgive you. But there are some people that just can't let something go. And that's in that great passage of Scripture. It says, if somebody has a problem with you, try to be reconciled with them. If they refuse to be reconciled, take a elder in the church with you to try and be reconciled. But if that doesn't work, and by the way, the Scripture, that great passage of Scripture says, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. That was not talking about worship or fellowship. It was talking about conflict. That Jesus is in the middle of conflict when we invite him to come into that. But he makes this statement, if you refuse to reconcile, if you refuse to forgive someone, he says this, what will be bound on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever is loosed on earth will be loosed in heaven. And let me tell you what that means. If you're walking around today with a bitter and an unforgiving and an angry spirit toward another believer in Jesus Christ, how on earth do you think you're going to exist in the utopic environment that is heaven? You're going to have to stand before Jesus Christ and answer for your bitterness and your hatred and your anger. You're going to have to stand before him, and he's going to say, listen, I forgave you. How come you would not forgive them? And let me share with you something. You and I have done far worse to our Lord than anyone has ever done to us. And so with that spirit in mind and that understanding, you have to learn that when you and I do not forgive others, when we live in constant elements of anger and upset, and we constantly want those people to hurt, you are not at peace. It blocks your very fellowship with God. Here's a second problem with unresolved conflict. It prevents answers to prayers. You know, in the marriage, there is this constant opportunity for conflict. Amen? I mean, there's always an opportunity for conflict. And it's important that husband and wife especially do not dwell or live in constant conflict. As a matter of fact, the essence of the Scripture says, do not let the sun go down on your wrath. If you let your anger remain in your heart and in your life, and you go to bed angry, you're going to wake up angry. And that becomes a cycle, and it's over and over and over and over. And husbands and wives need to understand that we need to reconcile that. We need to make that right. We need to be peacemakers, especially with one another. Here in this passage in 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 7, Peter takes direct aim specifically at husbands. Now, the application is true either way, but nonetheless, he focuses this principle to husbands, and there must have been someone that he knew in the church that this applied to. So he said, you husbands must be careful of your wives, being thoughtful of their needs and honoring them as the weaker sex. Do you see those words there? Being thoughtful, caring for them, honoring them. He says, remember that you and your wife are partners in receiving God's blessings. You see, when you become married, you become partners in the blessings of God. And he says this, if you don't treat her as you should, your prayers will not get ready answers. And if you're using your notes there, you know, you can kind of follow along when you circle that, will not get ready answers. That in the Greek is the word ekapto. Now, ekapto means your prayers are cut off. They're cut down. It is a word that is used when cutting down a tree. Your prayers are just cut off. They're cut down. They're frustrated. They're removed. God's not going to listen to your prayers if you're treating someone horribly. It's just not going to happen. And it's not just with wives. It's not just with your husband. It can be with your children. It can be with your friends, your neighbor. It can be with the people in your church, most specifically the fellow believer. God's not ready to answer your prayers. He's not going to listen to you if you don't have that spirit in your heart. Matter of fact, in the Old Testament, and you can write this down, Proverbs chapter 28 and verse 9, I love the Message translation of this. It says, God has no use for the prayers of those who won't listen to Him. In other words, you're not willing to listen to the Word of God. You're not willing to follow the Word of God. You're not willing to adhere to what God is revealing to you through the Word. Why is He going to listen to your prayers? You're a rebellious individual. You're filled with anger and hatred and bitterness. Why should God listen to your prayers? And then the third thing that happens, not just it blocks my fellowship, and not only does it prevent answers to my prayer, but it hinders my happiness. In other words, you're not happy when you're upset or angry or frustrated all the time. Why would you want to live like that? Let it go. Don't go down that path. Here in this passage that we're going to look at, we see that it really does hinder our happiness. In Job chapter 18, verse 4, and believe me, Job had ample reason to be upset, angry, frustrated. As a matter of fact, his wife got so upset, she said, curse God and die. But here we see that the advice that is given unto him in Job 18, verse 4 says, listen, Job, when you get angry and you get upset, you're only hurting yourself. Now that word hurting in the Hebrew is the word tarap, and it means to tear, to pull apart. When you are angry at someone and you're nursing that, you're nurturing that anger, you are just tearing yourself apart. You are just pulling yourself into pieces, and you are not at peace. Blessed are the peacemakers. You and I need to be peacemakers, because if we're not, it blocks our fellowship with God, it prevents answers to prayer, and it hinders my happiness. Now, what I want to do in the remaining time that I have in this lesson is I would like you to follow me in how to become a peacemaker. I've got this P-E-A-C-E. I'm using an acrostic so that you can kind of follow along with me. The first word of each element is going to be the first words to peace. Let's look at them, if you would. First of all, plan a peace conference. Now, that doesn't mean that you go out and you organize this situation. We're going to sit down. We're going to do this. I learned a long time ago, you cannot force people to reconcile. You can't. There are people that think, oh, we're going to deal with this right now. Everybody's going to get in a room. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. Believe me, I've tried that. And I can assure you, 100%, it never worked. Never. Never worked. As a matter of fact, it left the conflict unresolved. Now, with that in mind, you and I need to learn how to plan a peace conference. Now, we need to be able to do that. And I think a good verse is Romans 12, verses 14 and 18. The scripture says, and this is right along with peacemaking, it says, bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Is that not a profound statement toward peace? When someone does something that offends you or hurts you, when someone does something that is horrible to you, bless them. Bless them that persecute you. We learn that we can probably do that better with people than we can with organizations. When an organization hurts us, we get all riled up, and especially when they take our money. Amen? But nonetheless, we still need to understand that basic conflict deals with individuals. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. You're familiar with this passage. Be of the same mind toward one another. And then I'm jumping down just a little bit, but it says, never pay back evil for evil to anyone. Someone does evil to you, don't do evil back to them. That's not going to resolve the problem. And that is not being a peacemaker. It says, respect what is right in the sight of all men. And this is all reasonable men, not people who are caught up in belligerent bitterness. we need to understand that. Respect what is right in the sight of men. If possible, and this is the key, if possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. Now, the words there, as far as it depends on you, is a direct reference to your preparation, your planning, as far as you can manage in your own little situation. And then it says, be at peace with all men. That word, be at peace, is one word. It's irenuo, and it means to actually live in a situation of peace. All right, so we're living in a situation of peace with others. So you say, well, how do I plan a peace conference if I can't orchestrate and organize and say, okay, we're going to all meet on this day at this time. We're going to sit down. We're going to work out these differences, because that usually, and in my experience, it has never worked. I'll tell you what does work, though. When you plan a peace conference, you're preparing ahead of time for the opportunity of peace. You following me? You're preparing ahead of time for the opportunity of peace. You need to prepare and plan how you will promote peace in a situation of conflict with another person when the opportunity arises. Because it will arise. Because God wants peace. Now, you and I, we're not responsible to facilitate that peace and make sure it happens. You and I are responsible on our part to promote peace, to demonstrate peace in our heart and in our lives. There are some people that they don't want peace. They want anger, resentment, bitterness. They want all that goes along with it. They thrive on it. They love to be mad at other people. They love to be belligerent toward others. They love to stick their nose up in the air at another person and try to make them look bad in the eyes of others. There are individuals like that. Believe me, I've met plenty of them. But you can't be that way. You have to be forgiving in your spirit and in your heart. You need to be kind and gracious. You need to be the peacemaker. You need to bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. There are individuals that I have met throughout the years that there has been some measure of conflict, and I will bear this out. Nearly every conflict as a pastor I've had has been from the behavior of people who openly violated God's word, openly violated what Scripture says a believer is supposed to be and do, and the conflict has been a direct result of standing up for righteousness. And by the way, next week, that's what I'm going to be talking about. Blessed are you when you are persecuted for righteousness' sake. So I'm going to talk about that next week. But nearly every conflict I've had has been based on that as a pastor. Now, with that in mind, you understand that when you meet people out, you're going to run into them. You're going to see them at the store or in the community or at an event or at a funeral or a wedding. You're going to see them. And you need to be the adult. You need to be the one who demonstrates peace. I'm always kind and gracious to people. I always smile. I always encourage them. I'll reach out to shake their hand. I will always be that individual. And you need to be that individual. You need to be the peacemaker. Have a plan. Know how you're going to respond in a situation. And the more you plan, the more you prepare your heart, the more you develop that attitude of forgiveness and not holding offense toward others, it becomes second nature to you. It's easy to do. And you can go through life without harboring bitterness, resentment, anger, frustration. You can go through your life released, no longer worrying about those things. And when you demonstrate that in your life, when you demonstrate how you will show that peace, you become a peacemaker. So the first element is to plan a peace conference. Plan what you're going to say. Plan what you're going to do. There are a lot of people that sit down and rehearse not what they're going to do to promote peace, but how I'm going to get them back for what they said. I'm going to get them back for what they did. I'm going to make them sorry they ever did anything in my life. You're messed up if that's the way you think. The only person you're hurting is you. You need to understand that we are to bless those who persecute us, and we need to plan, to be, and to live in peace with all men. The second letter, the letter E, empathize with their feelings. Empathy is similar to sympathy, except it may be I've never experienced that. But there are experiences in your life where you've been upset, you've been hurt, you've been treated poorly, you have wanted to get back. You can empathize with their feelings. And that's the letter E, empathize with their feelings. Here's a great passage of Scripture. In Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, the Scripture says, "Now, if your experience of Christ's encouragement and love means anything to you," that's a big statement. If your experience of Christ's encouragement and love means anything to you, if you have known something of the fellowship of His Holy Spirit that lives within you, none of you should think only of his own affairs, but should learn to see things from the other people's point of view. If you're following in the notes, circle that word see. You should learn to see things from other people's point of view. That word see is the word scopeo, and it means to aim or regard, to contemplate. You and I need to think about what was a time in my life where I felt like I think they feel now, and we learn to empathize with their feelings. It'll help you in being better prepared with your peace plan, because now you can look at them and say, "I understand how you feel. That was not the intent. That's not what should be taking place." But you know, some people take offense at everything. Some people you cannot please at all. But bear that in mind. Try to be empathetic with their feelings. Here's the third thing, the letter A, P-E-A, attack the problem, not the person. A long time ago, I had to learn this lesson. People are not my enemy. Satan is my enemy. People may cause hard feelings and conflict, but they're not my enemy. Satan is my true enemy. And I need to attack the problems that have led to conflict instead of the person. You might have an individual who never wants to reconcile with you, but you know what you can do? You can set in place things that will attack that problem so that it doesn't happen again ever with the next person that comes down the pike. You can begin to prepare. Now, that doesn't mean you won't have a new situation, but you learn to attack the problem, not the person. And so that becomes an imperative if you want to be a peacemaker. In Proverbs 15 and verse 1, the Scripture says, "A kind answer soothes angry feelings, but harsh words stir them up." You ever heard the term, "I'm going in loaded for bear"? That's not a peacemaker. You do not go into a situation loaded for bear. You might in the actual situation lose a little control of your emotions and your situation at the moment, be angry about something. I've had that happen in my life on numerous occasions, and no doubt you have too. But when you have a peace plan, and you've planned out a peace conference, you have actually prepared yourself for that, and you understand that a kind answer soothes angry feelings, but a harsh one does nothing but stir them up. Doesn't do any good to get into an argument with somebody. You go through that process where you think, you know what, I'm going to say what's kind. I'm not going to say anything that's harsh or that will hurt people's feelings or bring this out and make it even worse than it is. You don't need to do that. Here in Ephesians 4:29, the Scripture tells us, don't say anything. Don't say anything that would hurt another person. As my mama said, if you ain't got nothing good to say, just keep your mouth shut. Don't say anything that would hurt another person. Instead, speak only what is good so that you can give help wherever it is needed. That way, what you say will help those who hear you. In other words, if you don't have anything good to say, just don't say anything. But when you do speak, speak what is good so you can help someone. Here is the next letter in the word peace, P-E-A-C. Cooperate as much as possible. I touched on that just a little bit in this verse of Scripture that's found in Romans 12 and verse 18, where Paul said, "Do everything possible on your part to live in peace with everybody." In other words, be responsible for what you can do. You can't You cannot force another person to cooperate, but you yourself can be cooperative. So do everything possible on your part to live in peace with everyone. Here's a great passage of Scripture in James chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. The wisdom that comes from God is first utterly pure, then peace-loving, gentle, approachable, full of tolerant thoughts and kindly actions, with no breath of favoritism or hint of hypocrisy. This is the way God deals with us. This is God's word. This is God's wisdom. And you and I want to emulate that wisdom before God. So take those things to heart. I don't have time to go through each one of them, but you read that yourself. You go to this passage of Scripture in James 3, verses 17 and 18. And then it says this, "And the wise are peacemakers." The wise are peacemakers who go on quietly sowing for a harvest of righteousness in other people and in themselves. In other words, you've had conflict. Great. Everyone has conflict. As a matter of fact, I think that's why God sets us in families. Because I got news for you. Families don't always get along. There are some family members that you need to love from a distance. Amen? And there are people in your lives that, even if they are believers, they might be a little like heavenly sandpaper. And so you got to be careful about that too. But let me share with you something. You and I can approach things wisely, pure, peace-loving, gentle, approachable, full of tolerant thoughts, kindly actions. We don't have to show any favoritism or hypocrisy. You and I can be peacemakers who quietly go on sowing for a harvest of righteousness. In other words, keep living your Christian life. Keep demonstrating these beautiful character traits that are ours through the Holy Spirit. What is it the Scripture says? The Holy Spirit doesn't just give us gifts. He gives us fruit of peace and love and joy and long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, temperance. You understand? We have these in our lives, and they manifest through us. And our primary objective is to reach other people for Christ, sowing a harvest of righteousness. Continue to lead people to Christ. Continue to invite folks to come to church. Continue to pray for and with unbelievers that they might come to know Jesus as their personal Savior. And quietly sow that harvest of righteousness in other people and in yourself. Living right, doing what's right, being right. And so with that in mind, cooperate. Cooperate as much as possible. The last letter is the letter E. And that letter represents for you and I to emphasize reconciliation, not resolution. Remember what I said before, some misconceptions about peacemaking? It's not avoiding and it's not appeasement. Sometimes people think that resolution means to bring about peace, but resolution does not always bring about peace, because resolution means essentially that I am solving the difference that we have. Let me share with you something. Sometimes you can never solve the difference. Sometimes the difference is so stark and so great that it cannot be solved. We've seen that throughout history. There are individuals that thought, well, I resolved this conflict. I solved the difference that these two individuals or these two mindsets or these two philosophies had with one another. But what you will discover is a little bit later, that person who was on the lower end of that spectrum, that did not have their needs met, that did not feel they were respected in their position or in their circumstance or their situation, that begins to bubble back up again. And you see that same conflict begin to arise over and over. That's what we deal with in nations, in families, in people. We see that that comes up to the surface again. You're not always going to be able to offer a resolution, but what you can offer is reconciliation. Now, the word in the Greek for reconciliation literally means mutual change. That's what reconcile means, or mutual change. And in this passage that I'm going to give you, let's look at an aspect of that. The scripture says, for if man is in Christ, he becomes a new person altogether. The past is finished and gone. Everything has become fresh and new. Is that a change? Absolutely. All this is God's doing. God did this. Why? He made us a brand new person, inside and out. He says, why? For he has reconciled. That's a mutual change to us. He has reconciled himself to us through Jesus Christ. He's reconciled us through Jesus Christ. You say, what happened? Well, God changed us. We were willing to be changed, and God changed us. So it was a mutual exchange. It was a mutual change that took place. God doesn't force you to change. God invites you to change. And when you accept that, I'm willing to change, God then changes too. He's no longer upset or angry because of our sin. He reconciles himself to us, and we are reconciled to him, and it's a mutual exchange. Did I stop being who I was? No. Did God stop being who he was? No. Am I still a sinner? Yes. Is God still holy? Yes. We do not have that ultimate, complete reconciliation, and we won't until one day we're standing before God in heaven and we have a new mind, a new heart, and a new body. We'll be totally reconciled at that point. And the scripture says, we shall be seen as we are seen. We shall know as we are known. We will be the sons of the living God, joint heirs with Jesus Christ. But until that happens, we have our significant differences. We still retain our personalities. We still retain our ideas and our concepts, our life experiences. But nonetheless, I am reconciled to God. I am no longer an enemy of God. Before, when I was a sinner, before when I had rejected Jesus Christ, I was an enemy of God. But when I received Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and I was willing and had a change of heart, and received him, God reconciled me to himself through Jesus Christ his Son. And because of that, we both had a change. I am no longer an enemy of God. Matter of fact, the scripture says, when I received Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, I became a friend of God. There are people in my life that I have a great friendship with, but we don't see eye to eye on everything. And we have had conflict in the past. But we love one another, we respect one another, and we treat one another with kindness and compassion. We did not resolve everything. It was not resolution that we needed. It was reconciliation that we needed. We're no longer enemies. That's the essence of it. And the scripture says that God did this himself between us and him. He reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ, and he has made us agents of the reconciliation. So you and I need to emphasize this reconciliation, that we're no longer enemies. We don't have to be enemies. We may not agree on everything. We may not see eye to eye. We may not have resolved all of the problem that was here, but we do not have to be enemies. And that is the emphasis of reconciliation. The Bible says God was in Christ personally reconciling the world to himself, not counting their sins against them, and has commissioned us with the message of reconciliation. How can we tell people to get right with God when we're not right with others who are around us, or we haven't even tried to be right with them? And that's the essence. You see, if you're walking around angry and you consider another believer your enemy, who's going to listen to you tell them about the love of Jesus? No one. No one's going to listen to you. Because they see your bitterness, they see your anger, they see your countenance, they see that you are holding and harboring that attitude toward another believer in Jesus Christ, and you are not demonstrating that you belong to him. Because the scripture says, by this shall all men know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. And love is not making ugly faces. Love is not turning your nose up at someone. Love is not talking about someone behind their back and destroying their reputation and their person to others. Love is not causing other people to vicariously carry your bitter, anger, ugly hatred toward another person in Christ. And remember what the scripture says that I told you earlier. If you say you love God, but you have hatred in your heart toward your brother, you're a liar. You don't love God. The only thing you love is your anger and your bitterness. And the scripture here says, you and I have been commissioned with the message of reconciliation. And that's not just with our mouth, but that is with our lives. And we are now Christ's ambassadors. To be an ambassador means you don't represent yourself. You represent the nation from which you come. And that is the kingdom of heaven. So you and I represent the kingdom of heaven. We are now Christ's ambassadors, as though God were appealing directly through us as his personal representatives. And what we say is, make your peace with God. But if you have prejudice in your heart, if you have anger and resentment and bitterness in your heart toward other believers, your message is very clear. Steer clear of God. Can you see the essence of this? The scripture says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be known as the sons of God. Just in closing, look at this verse with me. In Colossians 3:15, the scripture says, each one of you is part of the body of Christ. If you've received Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you're part of the body of Christ. And you were chosen to live together in peace. We're chosen to live together in peace. So, because of that, let the peace that comes from Christ control your thoughts and be grateful. Was it the old hymnist said, I surrender all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for your great love. Lord, I pray for anyone who may be listening to this, that they have harbored a bad and a bitter spirit towards someone. They've have been unforgiving. Lord, I pray you would set them free from that tonight. If they would just confess that and say, Lord, I need your forgiveness because I have not forgiven another. Help me to forgive them in order that I might be forgiven too. And Lord, just set them free from that. Give them the strength and the courage and the ability. You've given them this life of peace. Let them demonstrate that peace in their life toward others and even toward themselves. Dear friend, if you have been listening tonight and you say, Pastor Howard, I don't know for certain if I die that I'd go to heaven, but I'd like to know. Just pray this prayer. Will you do that? Just receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and he'll change your whole life. And you'll be reconciled to God, which is the first step of peace. You'll no longer be an enemy. You will be a dear friend and a son of the living God. Pray this with me. Just say, Lord Jesus, I come before you and I acknowledge my sin. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe that he died on the cross for me and that he was buried and that he rose again the third day. Lord Jesus, come into my heart and life. Be my Savior to forgive me. Be my Lord to lead me. And be my friend to walk with me through this life and into eternity. Thank you for the promise of a home in heaven with you. In Jesus' name. And dear one, if you prayed that prayer and you meant it with all of your heart, the scripture says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord and believe in their heart that God the Father has raised him from the dead, they shall be saved. I want to thank you for watching. As I said, next week, we're going to talk about the last of these lessons in the Beatitudes, number 8, which is, blessed are you when you are persecuted for doing what's right. Immediately after that, the following week, on July the 22nd, I hope you'll join me. We're going to begin looking at this great prophetic book, the book of Daniel. You don't want to miss out on any of this. We're going to talk all about this great presentation of this man of God in the book of Daniel. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. And may the Lord lift his countenance upon you to watch you wherever you may go. And may you always go in peace. God bless you. Keep looking up.